McGraw-Hill Ascent Audio presents Choose Your Customer: How to Compete Against the Digital Giants and Thrive by Jonathan L. S. Byrnes and John S. Wass. Narrated by Chris Sorensen. Publisher's Note: In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Introduction. The genesis of this book is a meeting that we recently had with the CEO of a multi-billion dollar distributor. He had just met with his management team about how Amazon and the other digital giants had entered his business and were steadily vacuuming up market share. This was the third meeting we had that week with CEOs of major companies asking us the same questions. How can I defend my company against these aggressive digital giants that have overwhelming digital capabilities and a price-cutting mentality? I'm cutting my costs across the board, but my profitability is dropping. What else can I do? How can I identify and invest in growing my real profit core, my business segments that will provide high growth, and remain profitable and defensible against my new competitors? How can I align my organization around my profit core and build dominance in my target market segments? As we outlined our experience helping companies overcome these issues, our thoughts turned to a seminal management committee meeting that we had with the top managers of one of the largest hospital supply companies several years earlier. The company's vice presidents gathered around a broad mahogany table in the company's boardroom. The president sat at the head of the table. As the operating review progressed, each vice president in turn said, "I made budget." When they got to the president, he looked at them and said, "That's great. I'm the only one who didn't make budget." What happened? As we dug into the situation, we saw that the vice president of sales had increased revenues, but the new customers had ordered products that were not stocked in the local distribution center. The vice president of operations was measured on a set of standard costs. He had to source these products from a distant warehouse, and he had beaten his budget by negotiating a lower freight rate. The company had increased budgeted revenues and decreased budgeted costs, but it had lost profits. This was not supposed to happen, and they did not see it until it was too late. We had just completed a project that developed the first vendor-managed inventory, which we describe in Chapter 1. In a nutshell, the company developed the capability to provide a new service with which it could deliver products directly to the patient care areas and clinics of its hospital customers. In the process, we found that the company's actual cost of the products depended on both the products themselves and the cost of the related services. But this cost not only varied from customer to customer, but also from product to product within a customer, depending on the location of each product's destination and other factors. This was both a huge opportunity and a major problem. The opportunity was that the company was carving out a new business that was completely defensible against price-cutting competitors who had a lower cost structure because they simply dropped their products off at the hospital's receiving dock. The problem was that the hospital supply market was fragmenting rapidly, as different customers wanted different packages of products and related services, while the company was set up to sell and deliver only a narrow set of products and services. The company needed to realign its market positioning, account selection, organization, and management processes with this new rapidly evolving segmentation. Moreover, when we tried to calculate the profits from the new system, we found a big problem. The company's traditional accounting system could not match each revenue increment with the actual cost of producing it because the traditional accounting categories, like revenue and cost, were too broad. When we simply spread the costs along the order lines, we got a wildly inaccurate picture, much like the hospital supply company president's discovery in his management committee meeting. Their traditional metrics and key performance indicators, KPIs, showed their average profitability but not their true, granular, rapidly shifting profit landscape. And this was happening in company after company. After some head-scratching, we developed a completely new way to analyze profitability, which we call transaction-based profit metrics and analytics. We carefully assign the correct costs to each transaction, invoice line, based on each transaction's actual costs, essentially creating an all-in P&L for each order line. For example, if a customer walked into a store and bought two pencils, an eraser, and a ruler, we produced three distinct all-in P&Ls, one for each transaction. Because each order line had a set of unique identifiers, for example, customer, product, store, sales rep, delivery, we could create a powerful data set that would combine and recombine the relevant transactions on a monthly basis to show the actual profitability of every nook and cranny of the company, especially their rapidly shifting profit peaks and drains that were hidden by their average metrics. This profit segmentation dramatically shows a company's true profit landscape, and it forms the basis for a powerful new and completely different way to analyze and manage a company, one that provides the basis for successfully competing with the digital giants, and which is central to Jonathan's graduate and executive courses at MIT. We developed a solution in Profit Aisle, our software as a service, SaaS Profit Solutions Company, to rapidly produce this analysis at high volumes, enabling managers to immediately focus on creating their highest payoff actions. We have analyzed tens of billions of dollars of client revenues using this solution, supporting management teams that have produced sustained 10 to 30% year-on-year profit increases, even in the presence of competition from the digital giants. When we stepped back and thought about how the digital giants' data-driven precision marketing was disrupting industry after industry, and the increasingly critical need for company profit metrics to match the rapidly changing business environment, we saw that company after company and industry after industry was undergoing a fundamental shift in the way that it needed to be managed. In essence, we have entered a new era of business. We are experiencing the end of the mass market era and accelerating into a new era, which we call the Age of Diverse Markets. The objective of this book is to explain how to manage and thrive in this new era by aligning your organization around your profit core, both current profits and your projected defensible market positioning, to build dominance in your target market segments. Book Overview. After the first section, The End of an Era, which provides historical context, this book has three main sections matching the three essential management steps you need to take to succeed in this new era of diverse markets and digital giants. Part 2, Choose Your Customer. Part 3, Align Your Company. And Part 4, Manage to Win. Choose Your Customer. Chapter 1, Today's Flood of Change, describes this sea change and explains what is changing. Not only is the basic management process changing, but the new era is also characterized by a broad shift in technology that has created a massive opportunity for a set of digital giants like Amazon to emerge and grow to dominate important segments of our economy. This chapter outlines how managers must change their management process to reposition for success in the new era. While the mass market era created an opportunity for limited product segmentation, for example, regular Coke versus Diet Coke, The age of diverse markets is characterized by much more extensive and complex segmentation involving both products and related services. The good news is that there are plenty of opportunities to grow and thrive in the new era, but it requires that management use true profit data to thoughtfully choose its target customers, align the company to capture, dominate, and grow its target segments, and manage its increasingly complex internal business processes to accelerate its focused growth and respond to its rapidly evolving market segment needs. Simply improving the efficiency of what a company always has done is a recipe for disaster. Chapter 2, Navigate the Currents of Change, identifies and analyzes the currents of change that are transforming industry after industry, ushering in the age of diverse markets. The chapter describes how these currents will differentially affect new entrants and incumbent firms. Chapter 3, Build Your Strategic High Ground, focuses on granular profit analytics, one of the most important manager capabilities in the age of diverse markets. The objectives are to explain how to analyze a company's profit peaks, profit drains, and profit deserts, and to give managers a practical understanding of how to build a set of management processes that put this information into action. Chapter 4, Manage to Thrive in a Period of Crisis, analyzes the impact of the current pandemic on companies, and it describes how managers can build a set of processes to grow customer loyalty, manage supply chain shockwaves, and accomplish productive downsizing. The goal is to enable managers to develop a program that will provide cash flow and profits during the crisis period, while building a strategy and set of management processes that will produce long-term sustainable success in the prolonged period that follows. Align your company. Chapter 5, Create a Winning Customer Value Footprint, explains how to identify and meet your target customers' deep needs by creating extended products and developing deep strategic product management capabilities. Chapter 6, Own Your Customer High Ground, focuses on the processes of selecting and managing customers, including pricing and strategic partnerships. The fundamental nature of a key account, that is, a profit peak customer, is changing dramatically, so it is critical that you choose your customers carefully so you are devoting resources to customers who fit your capabilities and strategic direction, and who will join you in building win-win relationships that give you both strategic dominance and long-run sustained profit growth. Chapter 7, Develop the Right Customer Relationships, discusses how to build the supply chains and channels that will enable you to effectively structure your customer relationships. The objective of this chapter is to explain how to design and manage this complex process. Manage to Win. Chapter 8, Manage at the Right Level, focuses on one of the most important enablers of company success. To succeed, managers at all levels of a company must shift their focus and management processes from the old command and control age of mass markets practices to those that will enable them to develop and manage the decentralized initiatives needed to win in today's age of diverse markets. This chapter explains how managers at the three key levels of management, top management, upper management, and operating management, can make this transition. In the final chapter, Become a Value Entrepreneur, we describe the evolving capabilities that will be the hallmarks of successful managers of the future. This set of capabilities, which we call value entrepreneurship, is rooted in the three key imperatives: choice, alignment, and management. We explain how managers can develop and perfect these new skills through both training and leadership experiences. The future holds a very exciting, rewarding, and productive opportunity for the next generation of managers. This book guides you in building a proven, pragmatic pathway to success. Part 1. The End of an Era. Chapter 1. Today's Flood of Change. Several years ago, the front page of the New York Times reported that two Columbia University geophysicists had found clear evidence of ancient villages lying beneath hundreds of feet of water on the seabed of the Black Sea. Their investigations, later narrated in a fascinating book, Noah's Flood, revealed that a sizable portion of what is now the Black Sea had once been a giant freshwater lake, filled with meltwater from Asian glaciers. About 7,600 years ago, as the last ice age waned and the waters rose, the Mediterranean Sea breached a high mountain barrier, and a monumental flood rushed through the Bosporus Valley, running through what we know today as Istanbul. Ocean water poured into the lake with historical force, destroying and submerging all life in the area, and formed the Black Sea. This was the actual event that storytellers memorialized as the biblical flood. Today, business is transitioning from one major era, the age of mass markets, to another, which we call the age of diverse markets. The two ages could not be more different, and the change is as inevitable and disruptive as the flood that created the Black Sea. While the transition began some time ago, it is rapidly accelerating, and the seismic shift is leaving managers scrambling for a practical pathway to succeed in a new, very different world. A new era. The age of mass markets, which extended through most of the prior century, was characterized by fast-growing homogeneous markets. Railroads and roads integrated diverse geographic markets, and many large national enterprises emerged. This was the age of the generals: General Electric, General Foods, General Motors, General Dynamics. And this management paradigm continued into the 1980s and 1990s with big box retailers like Walmart, Best Buy, and Staples. These companies were characterized by massive economies of scale in nearly every business function, production, distribution, advertising, and so on, which ensured that as they increased their sales, their unit costs dropped, giving them ample profits to invest in getting more sales and in further reducing their costs by increasing the efficiency of their production and distribution systems. Both prices and distribution costs were relatively uniform, so reporting tools based on averages, like aggregate revenues, costs, and gross margins, were sufficient. The key management imperative was to get big fast. The rules of thumb were that all revenues were good and all costs were bad. Companies segregated their functional departments to individually optimize their revenue-maximizing or cost-minimizing objectives, and they coordinated them at the top through periodic planning sessions and period-end financial reports. Today's age of diverse markets, which began its widespread acceleration around 2000, is completely different. Today, there are very few mass markets, while there are more and more diverse markets where product offerings, pricing, and service packages are uniquely configured. If not by individual customer, then at least by highly segmented target markets. Today, markets are heterogeneous and fragmenting down to the individual customer in many cases. Throughout our economy, pricing is becoming much more varied, both within market segments and even between one customer and the next. In parallel, the cost to serve each customer is becoming increasingly diverse, depending on the customer relationship, product-service mix, and other factors. This change has already overtaken the business-to-consumer, B2C markets, and it is rapidly transforming the business-to-business, B2B markets as well. In the age of mass markets, products were king. To a large extent, companies succeeded by selling the same products to as many customers as possible. In the age of diverse markets, in contrast, customers are king. Companies succeed by micro-targeting particular customers and tightly specific market segments and providing them with tailored packages of products and related services. In the prior era, companies won with top-down management processes that kept their revenue-maximizing and cost-minimizing functions separate. Today, companies win by choosing customers who fit their strategic positioning and serving them with highly integrated sets of products and services that are delivered through decentralized organizations and processes, while at the same time remaining flexible and adaptable to all types of change. In the past, managers needed only aggregate metrics, while today, they need to understand the relationship between revenue and cost for literally every product sold to every customer every time. The rise of the digital giants originated with their ability to market directly to customers, which enabled them to create micro-segments and to configure offers to individuals at scale using big data and algorithmic recommendations based on captured customer information. Today, as the age of diverse markets tsunami rushes in, industry after industry is being disrupted by digital giants like Amazon, Uber, Google, Facebook, Apple, and Alibaba, and by savvy incumbents that have staked out a strategic high ground and generated sustained profit growth. The wave is gathering speed and is pushing through the consumer landscape and into the B2B markets. Amazon is experimenting with placing Alexa, its voice-controlled device, throughout hospitals and in key manufacturing plants where supplies are ordered and used. Uber's rapidly growing Uber Freight is displacing many traditional trucking companies. Google acquired Fitbit, spearheading the company's move into the personal health and medical industry. The time frame for managing significant business change is 3 to 5 years, so organizations that are under siege from these forces must devise and initiate a response very quickly. The digital giants are moving fast, and even the pandemic crisis has not slowed them down. As we wrote this book, the COVID-19 pandemic was raging throughout the world. The crisis accelerated the relentless drive toward digital commerce and diverse markets, which made it even more urgent for companies to reposition for long-term success to compete with the digital giants. In Chapter 4, Manage to Thrive in a Period of Crisis, we explain how to create short-term profits and cash flow during a crisis, while at the same time repositioning for the long run. The steps that you need to succeed in a crisis, whether it's COVID-19 or anything else, are the same that you need to prosper when it ends. The biggest problem in business today is that all too many managers are not embracing the age of the diverse market success elements that will enable them to prosper. Instead, they are doubling down on tactical innovations and tuning up old practices from the age of mass markets, usually with diminishing results. Savvy managers, on the other hand, are realizing that the new disruptors are not winning by doing old things better, but instead by doing new things that incumbent companies are simply not capable of doing with their current business practices. The key to success in the age of diverse markets is choosing your customer. This has three imperatives. Choose. Define a defensible strategy that your company can dominate, choose the customers who fit, and say no to those who do not. Align. Identify and build the capabilities that will enable your company to achieve high sustained profitability with your chosen customers in your target strategic group, that is, the set of firms pursuing the same strategy, and focus your resources to quickly excel in your strategic direction. Manage. Develop your organization so your managers can seamlessly coordinate to identify and support your chosen customers and to meet their diverse and rapidly evolving needs. The objective of this book is to explain the currents of change that are creating today's disruptive tsunamis and to give managers a realistic pathway to success. One that involves managing in a new, creative, data-driven, and much more interesting way. In our experience across a range of industries, we have seen successful companies achieve long-term industry strategic leadership and sustain 10 to 30% annual profit growth, even while so many of their peers have run aground, victims of the devastating competition from the digital giants. The case of Edison Furniture. Perhaps the easiest way to explain the enormous pressures on business today and how to overcome them is with an example. We begin with a story about one of the oldest businesses undergoing a forced reinvention, the furniture business. The retail furniture industry is facing an upheaval. Mattresses are a major profit generator. However, focused new competitors, including specialty off-price retailers, mattress-in-a-box internet retailers, and manufacturers opening their own retail stores, are grabbing market share from traditional multi-line incumbents. The company we will name Edison, this is an actual company, but we are disguising the name, was under pressure from all sides. A majority of its customers were demanding that it match or beat the competitors' prices, so it responded by running TV ads featuring low prices. There appeared to be no way out of this price war, which the company seemed destined to lose because its higher-cost brick-and-mortar stores were competing with the internet sellers' much lower costs. In response, Edison decided to look more carefully at its data. Using transaction-based profit metrics and analytics, it created what was essentially a full all-in P&L for every transaction, that is, invoice line, literally every time a product was bought by a customer, which we will explain in the next chapter, to determine which parts of its business were making or losing money. When they saw the results, they nearly fell off their chairs. About 18% of their customers, which we call their profit peak accounts, accounted for about half of their revenues, but produced over 130% of their profits. About 30% of their customers, their large money-losing profit drains, accounted for about one-third of their revenues, but drained off about 50% of the profits earned by the rest of the company. About half of the company's customers were profit desert customers, who accounted for about 20% of the revenues and produced less than 10% of the profits. When Edison's managers saw this, they immediately understood that their price war strategy was a response to the profit-draining customers' demands, while they were essentially ignoring their critical high-profit customers. In fact, a few months earlier, they had conducted a marketing survey that had concluded that two-thirds of their high-revenue customers, a group that included both large profit peak and profit drain customers, were price shoppers. However, when Edison's managers saw the new transaction-based profit information, they realized that this new survey was fatally flawed, because it neglected to discover how many of these customers were high-profit customers, and it failed to investigate what those high-profit customers really wanted. Were they just shopping on price like the profit-draining customers, or were they looking for something else? In response, Edison sent a short, quick survey to a sample of its high-revenue customers, Audit carefully segregated the profit peak customers' responses from those of the profit drainers. What they saw was startling. Each group was homogeneous, but the two customer groups could not be more different. The profit peak customers were all very store loyal. They liked to shop at the store, and they often had a trusted sales rep who guided their purchases. They referred their friends and family to the store, and that is how they had found it, and while they were not wealthy, they were relatively insensitive to prices. The profit drainers, on the other hand, were classic price shoppers. They often started shopping at one of the company's stores, then went comparison shopping at the off-price and internet retailers. They finished by returning to the company's store to demand that it match the lowest price they had found and deliver the strong service that Edison was known for. This led Edison to change its competitive positioning to respond to the onslaught of low-cost, low-service internet competitors. It focused on building its business with the profit peak customers in several ways. It fed the profit peak customers' entries into its Salesforce customer relationship management system so that they were recognized as soon as they entered the store and were sent immediately to their favorite sales rep, who had on his or her iPad a history of the customer's buying preferences, both for style and accessories like high-profit warranties. The profit peak customers were offered special services, including after-hours appointments with their favorite sales reps, and customer concierge services to help with appointments, answer questions, and respond to requests. Edison instructed its best product managers to develop store-brand private label products, which were much more profitable than branded products, and which the high-profit customers actually preferred. The sales reps were instructed not to negotiate price discounts with the profit-draining customers, whom they could recognize from the notations in the Salesforce system. Advertising themes changed from low prices to high service and quality store-brand products, and the company started holding regular friends and family after-hours wine and cheese parties for its profit-peak customers and their guests. Delivery services were changed to focus customer service on high-profit customers. The director of delivery noted that about one-third of the drivers were very good at customer service, while the other two-thirds of the drivers simply liked to drive. He stationed the service-sensitive drivers in neighborhoods where the profit-peak customers lived and had the other drivers shuttle trucks of furniture to them. This freed the master drivers to do all the profit peak customer interactions, including noting other furniture needs and preferences that they could report to the sales rep, who would follow up. The best news was that when Edison Furniture looked at the currents of change that were buffeting the industry, it saw that it had carved out a defensible, high-growth, high-profit strategic group that the powerful digital and off-price competitors could not enter with their low-price, low-service strategies. Edison's executives noted that their high-profit customers required more costly service, but they realized that this was a great investment as the extra cost was easily justified by the accelerated profits. They also realized that simply maximizing revenues by pursuing profit-draining customers was causing them to lose money hand over fist. Edison's management made the brave strategic decision to abandon the revenue from its profit-drained customers and to stop their old practice of meeting the lowest price in the market. They were pleasantly surprised to find that a significant number of the profit-drained customers eventually purchased from Edison at full price anyway, so they could get Edison's legendary great service. Importantly, since most of the key elements of this strategy were already present in the company, it could manage the transition to the new strategy by using its current resources. Management was delighted to find that the new strategy generated significant new cash flow from the start which paid for the additional changes needed to complete their strategic shift. Edison succeeded because it chose its customers by identifying its high-profit defensible strategic group. It aligned its resources around the processes and technologies that supported its chosen customers, and it managed the coordination of its key functional areas, sales, products, and customer relationships, to meet its customers' needs and not to maximize all revenues and minimize all costs. Edison's customer profit segmentation, dividing the customers into profit peaks, profit drains, and profit deserts, was essential to choosing its strategic group. When Edison's managers used their transaction-based profit metrics and analytics to determine the actual all-in profit of every customer, man product, store, and so on, they saw that their customers clustered naturally into these three profit segments. Figure 1.1 provides a profit map, that is, a summary characterizing a set of profit segments of Edison's customers. Once Edison's managers examined the company's profit map, they determined that their profit peak accounts formed an existing and defensible core set of customers that would endure in the transformed industry as the currents of change played out, so they could anchor their choice of strategic group in this customer set. As a result, they could figure out the tactics that would enable them to secure and grow their profit peaks, convert as many profit drains as possible into profit peaks, and focus on lowering the cost to serve their profit deserts. This gave them a clear game plan for aligning and managing the company. The case of Baxter. A second example of how companies can reinvent their priorities, beat back competition, and discover astonishing new sources of profit comes from the medical industry, specifically a hospital supplier named Baxter. We highlight this case because it was one of the landmark innovations that started the transition to the age of diverse markets, and because it shows how Baxter, in its healthcare business market, paralleled the situation that Edison faced in its B2C market. Intense competition, price transparency, and a seemingly no-win situation. Like Edison, Baxter had to shift its focus from selling traditional products to creating innovative ways to meet its customer needs. And just as it was for Edison, choosing its customers and realigning its organization were the keys to Baxter's success. Baxter was stuck in the mud. The company sold a variety of hospital supplies, like intravenous, IV solutions, and plastic sets to deliver drugs and fluid to patients. The business was racked with constant price wars. A 5-year hospital contract would hinge on whether the price was, say, $1.05 versus $1.03 per liter. The decision makers were hospital pharmacists who were price buyers. Baxter's management found that its core strategy of selling commodity products with minimal and identical services to all customers was creating chronic price wars with giant competitors that were doing the same thing. The company needed a way to break out of this shrinking strategic box and redefine its business. Baxter assembled a small team to investigate how to raise its profitability. The team carefully examined the company's sales and operating costs. They saw that the company was quite efficient. It appeared that there was little that could be done. Then the team had an inspired thought. All their cost reduction work had naturally focused on the activities within Baxter's four walls, just as their competitors were doing. During a brainstorming session, the team had a quirky thought. They wondered what happened to the products within the hospital from the time they were received until they were administered to the patients. They thought that this information might provide a way to break out of their shrinking strategic box. Surprisingly, the team had little knowledge of these activities. Soon the team fanned out to visit several hospitals, pursuing their hunch that they might find something useful. They were amazed to find that in hospital after hospital, the products flowed through a series of internal supply chain steps, many of which replicated those that took place in Baxter. Moreover, the steps were poorly organized and were accomplished at volumes that were too small to achieve even a minimum efficient scale. The team conducted a study at a major hospital to measure the cost of each supply chain step. They divided the supply chain into a set of discrete steps, for example, deciding what to order, determining how much to order, transmitting the order, and interviewed all relevant hospital personnel, for example, purchasing personnel, materials management personnel, nurses, to determine how much time each person spent on each step in a typical week. They scaled these numbers by the loaded labor rate to calculate the hospital's supply chain cost by activity and department, giving them transaction-based profit information. The study's results shocked everyone on the team and in the hospital. For many important products, the total cost of the supply chain activities exceeded the cost of the supplies. Departments that were not thought to be involved in supply chain activities, like nursing, constituted a surprisingly large proportion of the costs. For the nurses in particular, the time and cost of supply chain activities nearly equaled the cost of patient care, an immensely important insight in this period of skilled nursing shortages. No one had even imagined that this picture would emerge. Careful studies in multiple hospitals confirmed that this was the norm. The cost landscape of hospitals surprised and amazed all those involved. To illustrate, if the cost to the hospital of a liter of IV solution was about $1, the total cost by the time it was administered to a patient was about $7, and of the $6 difference representing the cost within the hospital, about half or $3 was avoidable. While the suppliers and the hospital were bickering over a few pennies, about $2 to $3 in cost reductions were hidden but addressable through process improvements. When the hospital's top managers saw this cost picture, they came to Baxter and essentially said, "We just have two questions. First, can you really do this? And second, can we trust you?" As one of the largest and most reliable hospital suppliers, Baxter could authentically answer yes to both questions. Besides, Baxter's managers had the advantage of creating the new system, and their careful efficiency calculations showed them the exact ways to reduce costs that later imitators never saw. This new strategy allowed Baxter's managers to shift the decision-maker buying their products from the price-oriented pharmacist to the hospital's top managers. For the first time in many years, they found themselves in the driver's seat of their hospital relationships. Based on the comprehensive hospital study information, verified in a number of hospitals, the team suggested a new system that would integrate the supply chains of Baxter and the hospitals. Baxter called it the stockless system, now called Vendor Managed Inventory or VMI, later rebranded as Value Link. It is still a critical element in Cardinal Health's hospital supply services. This portion of Baxter's business was eventually spun off and later purchased by Cardinal Health. Under the stockless system, a Baxter Materials Management Coordinator was resident in each hospital. The coordinator was not a sales rep, but rather a floor supervisor from Baxter's Distribution Center, DC. Using a new, efficient protocol, the coordinator counted the products in each of the hospital's patient care areas and clinics and transmitted the order information for each patient care area and clinic to Baxter using a handheld device. At the Baxter DC, a special section of the warehouse was devoted to the stockless system. It was carefully designed for picking individual items like two boxes of bandages, which are called eaches, in contrast with the main sections of the DC that were set up to handle bulk items like cases and pallets. After receiving the hospital orders at the DC, a dedicated set of DC personnel packed each order into a set of special totes, with each tote addressed to the specific hospital patient care area or clinic that generated the order. At the end of the day, the totes were loaded onto delivery trucks and brought to the hospitals. They were received using statistical receiving, that is, inspecting a sample of high-value products, made possible by highly audited Baxter shipping verification protocols, and then moved to the respective patient care areas or clinics at night. The Baxter coordinators put the products away and returned the totes to the stockroom for transportation back to Baxter the next day. The new stockless system resulted in three major benefits. One expected, another a surprise, and a third completely unexpected. First, the stockless system reduced the hospital's supply chain costs by over 30%. It reduced costs in several ways. By eliminating the redundancies between Baxter and the hospitals, by substituting the use of Baxter's systems operating at efficient scale, and by identifying and rectifying inefficiencies in the prior hospital operations. For example, eliminating the massive amount of time nurses had been spending going to the stockroom to get missing supplies. Baxter had found a way to escape from its shrinking strategic box by building a bigger box around its business, which opened a new world of possibilities for expanding what we call its customer value footprint. That is, the value that a company provides to a customer. In the process, Baxter redefined its business. Second, the Baxter managers were surprised to find that their own operating costs dropped by over 30%. Baxter now controlled the hospital order pattern. Baxter's managers could balance the hospital inventories with the ordering pattern by building a little more stock of inexpensive supplies, which helped reduce order frequency, by spotting early trends and proactively building inventories to avoid expediting costs, and by directing hospital staff to alternative stocking locations within the hospital when needed. Third, and completely unexpectedly, Baxter's product sales rose by over 35%, even in the most highly penetrated hospitals in the country. This massive sales increase was driven by the efficiency and performance of the stockless system, which greatly eased the burden on all the hospital personnel involved, especially the nurses. Just as important, a very strong working relationship, rooted in ongoing problem-solving and jointly finding ways to improve the system, developed between the head nurses and the Baxter coordinators. This effectively made Baxter the preferred vendor. When it became clear that the stockless system was a major revenue generator, the sales reps, who previously tried to keep the team out of their important accounts, did an about-face. They quickly tried to get all their accounts to the head of the line for the new system because they expected huge commissions on the big sales increases. It soon became clear that the company needed a more systematic way to decide which accounts would get the new system and a way to prioritize the accounts in light of Baxter's limited capacity to implement the new system. For the first time, Baxter had to choose its customers. And this ran completely counter to its established practice of treating all customers alike. The answer was what we call market mapping, matching customers to the relationships that they should have, not necessarily to the relationships that they initially want. The market mapping process involves sales managers, marketing managers, and supply chain managers. Once the market mapping team decides on the right relationship that the company should have with a customer, it is the job of the sales rep, often in combination with the supply chain manager and other members of the multi-capability account team, to sell the account into that relationship over time. In targeting accounts for these relationships, the team found four key factors. 1. The amount of the potential profits at stake. 2. The operating fit. 3. The account's willingness and ability to partner. And 4. The account's buyer behavior, That is, relationship versus transactional. The team also saw that it needed to define a small number of alternative relationships, which we call a relationship hierarchy, for accounts for whom full integration did not fit. Through this process, Baxter was able to align its sales process, product service mix, and organizational processes to fit the respective needs of its various target customers. A second big issue that arose was whether to offer the service only for products that the hospital bought from Baxter, or to offer the service for all hospital products. This discussion was heated, with the sales and product managers adamant that the service was a critical incentive for selling Baxter products and should be offered only for Baxter products. Baxter's president thought about this issue and reasoned that the stockless system was creating a pipeline flow into the hospitals that helped hospitals reduce costs, eliminate redundant personnel, and free up nurses' time. Unless Baxter handled all the hospital's products, the hospitals could not achieve the full cost savings and efficiency improvements made possible by the stockless system. Therefore, stockless had to handle all hospital products. A related question arose. Should Baxter charge for the stockless system, or should the company offer it as a perk to large volume customers? Again, the sales and product managers argued that it should be considered a sales incentive and be made available at no cost to big accounts. The president turned down this argument, explaining that because hospitals would have to make significant internal changes to implement the system, charging for the system would force them to acknowledge the value they would be receiving. Moreover, it would provide an incentive to make the changes. With these important strategic decisions in hand, Baxter rolled out the stockless system using multi-capability teams tailored for each target hospital. As expected, the teams encountered some operating issues, but importantly, the system produced major benefits. Stepping back, what did this fundamentally new way of doing business signify for managers? The stockless system, just like other forms of close supplier-customer integration and cooperation, heralded a major shift in the nature of business and contributed to the age of diverse markets. First, it unleashed huge new profits by eliminating the inefficiencies that lay hidden for decades between companies, rather than addressing only issues within companies. Second, the stockless system created decisive strategic differentiation. It enabled Baxter to integrate with its most important customers, which fostered very strong operating ties. Baxter created a new lucrative strategic group which was defensible against both traditional and digital competitors. Moreover, this strategy invited and underpinned critical hospital strategic initiatives. For example, prior to this partnership, hospitals were reluctant to develop remote facilities and clinics because they lacked confidence in their managers' ability to support these complex operations. The Baxter partnership gave them confidence to do this, which transformed hospital strategies. Competitors with arm's-length strategies, for example, only shipping in bulk to hospitals receiving docs, even digital giants with big data, could not possibly match Baxter's rapidly evolving customer value footprint. Third, this innovation was not about the products. It was all about Baxter developing enduring strategic advantage and financial gains from its customer-oriented go-to-market innovations, one of the hallmarks of the new age of diverse markets. Fourth, when Baxter used transaction-based profit information to guide its own business, it discovered its prices and cost to serve varied widely depending on the customer relationship, the service package, and other salient factors. Without its granular new transaction-based profitability information, Baxter managers would not have been able to select the right target accounts, match those customers to the right relationships by aligning their cost to serve with the customer's profit potential, and develop the right custom-tailored packages of products and services to fit their target market segments and customers. Like Edison, Baxter succeeded because it chose its customers by identifying those who fit its high-profit, defensible strategic group. It aligned resources around the processes that supported its chosen customers, and it managed the coordination of its key functional areas, sales, products, and customer relationships to meet its customers' needs. Like Edison, Baxter understood that the old model of maximizing all revenues and minimizing all costs was a losing proposition. Who wins big? Today, every market is changing rapidly, with most companies reducing their supplier base by 40 to 60%. The all-important question of who stays and who goes is rarely made on product characteristics alone, or even price. The decision on who wins big and who gets pushed out is almost always determined by a supplier's go-to-market capabilities. Namely, the ability to choose its customers, to produce more essential customer value through an innovative value footprint, and to create new profits and strategic advantage for the customers. The overriding management issue is that this change in business eras is creating a critical need for a shift from broad market targeting to focused segment and even customer selection. In today's age of diverse markets, choose your customer is the most important theme. In order to succeed, companies have to abide by the three imperatives we highlighted before. 1. Choose. Define a defensible strategic group that your company can dominate and select the most lucrative customers within it. 2. Align. Identify and build the capabilities that will enable your company to achieve high sustained profitability in your target strategic group. And 3. Manage. Develop your organization to enable your managers to seamlessly coordinate to meet your chosen customers' diverse and rapidly evolving needs. This shift, in turn, requires much more granular profit information. In essence, a full P&L on every transaction, and a shift to an organization that can create and supply tightly coordinated packages of products and services aimed at a company's increasingly divergent market segments and even individual customers. In a nutshell, this is the key to success today. But most managers have been blinded by their experience in the fading age of mass markets, in which all revenues are assumed to be good and all costs are seen to be bad. This is the overriding management problem that our book is designed to address. The currents of change. In Chapter 2, we describe in detail the currents of change that are ushering in the age of diverse markets. Managers must understand and address these changes in repositioning their organizations. The five currents propelling this tsunami of change are these. Rapid technology innovation. Technology is revolutionizing industry after industry. Think about this. Computers, mobile commerce, and even the internet were not in widespread use until the tail end of the prior century. Now smartphones have more computer power than was packed into the Apollo spacecraft. Drones and self-driving cars are on the near horizon, and less known but equally revolutionary technologies like robotics and additive manufacturing, in which devices are built with powdered metal under heat treatment rather than sculpted by metalworking parts, are capturing increasing market share. At the same time, artificial intelligence, AI, and machine learning are enabling managers to optimize their companies and customer relationships in powerful new ways. In many cases, getting every transaction right every time. All these are making the mass customization of products and services both possible and competitively necessary. New buyer behavior. New forms of buyer behavior are emerging, upending traditional sales and marketing relationships. In addition to the new internet retailers and distributors bringing powerful B2C processes like omnichannel retailing, which takes a lot of experience to perfect, disruptive companies and their millennial customers are moving toward higher levels of price transparency and service expectations. Managers responding to the former must offer carefully constructed sets of products and services, creating hard-to-follow packages, while managers facing the latter must create new forms of mass customization, especially involving highly integrated customer relationships. Managers have to create alternative approaches that the internet competitors and other disruptors cannot follow.
Channel boundaries. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.